This is the second time that we meet this week to discuss some of the challenges and implications and potential implications and actual implications of Brexit. We had the opportunity to listen to a colleague from Aberdeen a couple of nights ago, Professor Michael Keating, who gave us his perspective on the domestic internal implications of Brexit. And today we're expanding this conversation to the more international realm, which concerns us all as professionals in the field of international politics, or however we want to call it, and make this relevant also to the wider community in Aberystwyth. So it's a great opportunity to have Sir Emyr with us today. As you probably know, this Department of International Politics has a very long-standing and outstanding tradition in the field of international relations, and we're very well known in the whole world for having contributed in very innovative and bold ways to the understanding of constantly changing international environments for about a century now. And the innovations of this department have been on all levels, empirical, theoretical, meta-theoretical. But we have another tradition which is equally important and which has probably helped us to develop this academic excellence throughout decades. And that other tradition is our ability to engage with the world of international practice, with the world of practitioners, both in a way that is open and critical. Although I think today we're going to be more on the side of openness. One of the things that we take from practitioners, of course, is their ability to illuminate international politics in a way that we don't necessarily systematically do, or that we don't aspire to do, precisely because of the kind of distance and so-called detachment that the scholastic or academic perspective often dictates on us. Sometimes we forget also that our theories and models leave out the realm of experience and practice and lived experience. And this is why it's always very useful for us to turn to practitioners who are not only political agents who should be held accountable for what they do in the name of the people, the state, etc., but who are also different kinds of knowing subjects who experience the world in very different ways. And so today it's a great pleasure to welcome a gentleman who happens to be the Chancellor of this university, but who is also a career diplomat who spent over three decades serving the United Kingdom and probably beyond the United Kingdom, indirectly the European Union as well, the European Union that we will be leaving apparently very soon. And these were fascinating decades, the last two decades of the Cold War, the end of the Cold War, and the emergence of whatever new world order we've been promised with, unipolar, multipolar, post-9/11, post-Trump, depending on how you conceptualize this timeline, a very complex international politics. But it is quite a unique opportunity to actually listen to a practitioner who has contributed to diplomatic practice at so many different levels, and who can speak to us with this very multi-layered perspective, having contributed to national, regional, European, and also international diplomacy and levels of governance. So Sir Emyr, in addition to being the political director of the UK Foreign Office, has also represented the UK at NATO and been the British ambassador to the UN. So I think this is quite a comprehensive view of foreign policy, at least for this country. And it is therefore a great privilege for us to listen to him and see what he can tell us. I know he's a bit upset, to say the least, but many of us are. Whether we are temporary or permanent residents of the UK, this is going to be a very interesting and challenging period. So Sir Emyr has accepted to speak for about 30 to 40 minutes. And without further ado, please join me in welcoming him.
Thank you for the introduction, and thank you all for turning up. If I'd known you were going to turn up in such large numbers, we'd have made it an all-ticket event and contributed to the university's budget, but thank you for coming. Referendum decided, Supreme Court decreed that Parliament should vote, Parliament voted last night, white paper issued today, although I hasten to add I've not read it yet, and the government wishes and intends to trigger Article 50, the exit route to the European Union, by 31 March. I want to talk about what is now going to happen. Brexit means Brexit.
Yeah.
But we the people have decided, but just to do what? What have we decided? To leave the European Union, yes, but what? So I'm going to try and explain what are for me the most complex set of negotiations that any British government in my lifetime has ever tried to embark upon, and explain how difficult, lengthy, and interrelated the different aspects are. They affect the United Kingdom's future international position, they affect the internal structures of the United Kingdom, and as you heard a couple of evenings ago, they affect the very unity of the United Kingdom. That's what's at stake. Article 50 in the Treaty of European Union is the glide path to exit. Until that treaty, there was no means of leaving. Nobody thought that anyone would wish to leave. Well, Article 50 said if anybody does, this is what you do. And the important thing about it is that once you trigger it, there is then envisaged a negotiation between the Council and the departing state, but that whatever happens, agreement or no agreement, 2 years from that trigger, you will be leaving and will have left the European Union. The only thing that can change the 2 years is if the Council, by qualified majority, and a majority of the European Parliament agree to extend that deadline. But if they don't, with or without an agreement, we're out. Okay? That's what's going to happen. Now, I want to contend this afternoon that there are six different sets of issues that need to be addressed. The wits who say, well, we've decided to leave, just leave. Get on with it and leave. It is not as simple as that to unscramble relations which go back to 1973 and all the complexities that have been put in place among all the member states of the EU over that period and between the European Union and the rest of the world since 1973. Let me start with Article 50 itself. Very simple, isn't it? Just to agree the terms that we leave. Except what needs to be covered in those negotiations? The issues include, right, this is not definitive, but they include the European Union financial perspectives, that is, the planned expenditure of the EU, runs from 2014 to 2020. That's the commitment that the 28 have taken on. The problem is that if we invoke now, by the 1st of April 2019, we will no longer be members, and presumably, for those who think we're out and it's very simple, we will not be paying anything into the European Union budget. Problem. We are net contributors. Not that high, but substantial net contributors. And the shortfall is going to be tens of billions each year in the EU budget. Because that's money in net terms that we put in. And it's expenditure that the 28, including us, have agreed to do. So what's going to happen to that expenditure? Do they just say, well, there's a shortfall, let's spend less? Do they say, will all the 27 spend more? Or shall we charge the United Kingdom for the sum that it would have paid in had we still been members of the EU? And the Commission is arguing that last point. And the sum is between 40 and 60 billion euros. So the first demand on their part is going to be to say, well, could we have back, please, up to 50 billion pounds as the commitment you entered into when you were part of all those decisions. On the other side of the same coin, there are universities in Wales and all over Britain and Objective 1 areas in Wales which believe they are going to be having EU financial assistance up until 2020. are they still going to get it after we leave? Or is it simply going to be substituted by expenditure from the British government, from the monies it thinks it's saving for the contribution it's no longer making? Or is it going to be a mix? And we've already had some commitments on Objective 1 and on research, where the British government has said, we will make good planned expenditure in the UK from the EU up to 2020. There's a legal argument there. There's a far bigger political question. If you're sitting in Berlin and you're saying, well, if the Brits are leaving, that's potentially another 20 billion euros for us to pay, and we're already subsidizing those guys in the south so much. And by the way, we've got an election coming up in Germany in September. How's that going to play? The demands, I'm sure, from the 27 are going to be very simple. Cough up, give us the money. That's what you signed up to, that's what you owe us. And if you pay that, we'll continue the pattern of expenditure in the EU that is also planned. But of course, in net terms, we're in for this sizable amount, which is our net contribution to the budget. There are acquired rights that individuals have as citizens of the European Union. And there's a very difficult legal argument as to whether those acquired rights persist when you leave the EU. They're guaranteed at the moment by the treaties, and there are a lot of people, very distinguished lawyers, believe those rights should continue. But there are very simple rights, like the right of residence, that any of you as EU citizens currently have, say, to live in Spain. What's going to happen to that right after you leave? What's going to happen to the right of these 100,000 or so Brits living in Spain now? What about the 500,000 more EU citizens living in the United Kingdom, working in the United Kingdom, contributing in the UK? They've been held ransom at the moment because it's part of this negotiation, although the common sense and appropriate response would be to say that everybody's right of residence should actually be guaranteed. They came in on that basis. There are shared liabilities. It hasn't been much remarked upon, but there are two European Union agencies in London. There's a thing called the Joint European Torus. It's the fusion experiment in Cullum. What's going to happen to those? They're going to move. What are the liabilities? What are the pension liabilities of British people who used to work in the European institutions? Who's going to keep paying those? Where's that money coming from? What are the entitlements of EU citizens in either place, both in terms of social security, health? If there are currently legal cases going on in the European Court of Justice involving past misdemeanors by, say, the British government or parts of the United Kingdom, if the judgment comes out after we've left, are they still effective? Do we still have to pay compensation if we're required to? But what happens to those legal judgments? What happens to the sanctions that we invoke against Russia, lots of other places, because we're members of the European Union? They're just some of the issues that need to be sorted out. So that's number one. Article 50, an agreement concluded, the language says it should take account of that state's future relations with the European Union. That, from a British ideal viewpoint, would mean that we would have concluded our future relations with the European Union, put that in a binding form, and for that to come into effect the moment we left. Now that's a pipe dream, and I'll explain why later. But there are people in the European Commission and some member states who are now arguing that we should have no discussions whatever about the future relations until we've concluded the Article 50 agreement. So just imagine what will happen on the 1st of April 2019 if that argument prevails. Cliffs and falling off come to mind. The future relations will be under Article 217, 218 of the Treaty of European Union, and that is by qualified majority and the consent of the European Parliament. But there's provision in it that where aspects of the agreement require unanimity, then the whole agreement would require unanimity. And moreover, this is the bad news, if, as is inevitable, if there's a super British EU agreement for the future relations, it will cover aspects which in the jargon are within the competence of member states. And it then becomes what's called a mixed agreement. And if it's a mixed agreement, the ratification of that agreement requires the approval of each of the governments in the 27 and the approval of an international treaty by their own national processes. In shorthand, it means each of their parliaments would have to confirm the agreement. In the case of Belgium, that could mean up to 7 parliaments. And we saw in the Canadian agreement recently that Wallonia said no. But don't bank on 27 countries, all of whom are feeling pretty cheesed off with the British, actually to say, yes, willingly, we'll pass this agreement straight off. It ain't going to happen, okay? Quite apart from the complexity. So it's difficult. What do we want in this agreement? And this is without the benefit of having read the white paper, but we want favorable trade terms, including services. We want to retain much of the cooperation on police, justice issues, security, future participation in EU research programs, Erasmus for students, free movement of academic staff. We'd all be arguing for that. The measures that benefit citizens, travel, you can go with Ryanair cheaply to Seville because of EU legislation. If we're outside, do we still have the benefit of the same air transport agreements with any other country in the 27? Answer, no, you've got to find a substitute for that. What do we do about foreign policy cooperation? I'll come back to that. But let me remind you that in terms of trade, 44% of our exports go in goods and services to the other 27. That's a surplus of £20 billion on services and a deficit on goods of £89 billion. So the ones who say, let's get out, and of course they have this vested interest because of their exports to us, we should remember that for the other member states, on average, 6 to 7% of their exports come to us. So if all trade stopped, they'd still be exporting 93% of their exports. We'd be exporting 56%. That's the sharp dichotomy, but which doesn't necessarily come out in the arguments. Now, I'm going to digress from my list of things that need to be done, and bear with me, to say that in terms of the EU future arrangements with the United Kingdom, I want to set out to you there are 5 options that I can think of. And I'll try and describe the advantages and disadvantages of each. Now, the first is just join the European Economic Area. After all, you're joining Liechtenstein, Iceland, and Norway. But you would be in a position where you would have access in a single market of goods to that market. And that, what that means is unhindered access, no tariff barriers, and no non-tariff barriers. You would not have access for services. You would not be in the customs union, but there'd be a continuity. But, now comes the big but, you would have no say whatever over the rules that the EU enacted on the internal market, and you would be expected automatically to transfer existing and future rules enacted by the 27 into British law just like that. No chance of appeal, no chance of trying to change them. You've just got to do it. But you would have unfettered access. So when at least two national governments talk about unfettered access, they actually need to understand what unfettered access means. Prime Minister said very clearly, British government's not prepared to accept the jurisdiction of the European Court of Justice when we've left. But if you have an internal market, if you have the European Economic Area, there has to be a court to adjudicate any problems. There is such a court, it's called the EEA court, but it's essentially the ECJ with a few bells on it. The other thing that Norway accepts, and if anybody's been to Norway recently, you'll see the nature of society is changing because they've had to accept free movement as a condition, actually, of being in the EEA. They're also, not often remarked upon, they are the ninth biggest contributor to the EU budget, because that was the price they had to pay to become members of the EEA. So they're not in justice and home affairs either. So the answer, the British government says no to that, and there are good reasons why the European Economic Area is a problem. But let me cover one thing as well. Scotland has said, well, if the rest of the UK doesn't want to be in it, we want to be in it. I know of no precedent where part of a member state has signed up to such a policy. And it's massive, of course, because it's a substantial bit of what the European Union does. But hypothetically, if Scotland could sign up to it, or if Wales could, and England doesn't, then the difference between England and Scotland in terms of trade policy is no different to the difference between Scotland and Canada. I.e., England would be outside, and you'd have to have controls, certificates of origin, whatever, in any trade that happened between England and Scotland, which eventually led to a contribution from England being part of a Scottish export into the European Economic Area. Have I said that clearly enough? But that's what it means. And put simply again, it means a disintegration of the single market called the United Kingdom. And that feeds in directly to, I'm sure, what was said the other evening. So, not easy. So let's try the next one. Let's stay in the customs union. Well, there's continuity. On the point about a customs union, no tariffs between, so tariff-free access, but you have to have a common external tariff with the rest of the world. So there are no rules of origin problems in terms of customs procedures, but you lose immediately the British flexibility to negotiate any agreement with any third country, because it has to be an EU agreement with the third country, which you latch onto. That's how it would go. Now, staying in gives you the advantage that the 53 or so countries who have free trade agreements with the European Union, you would still be able, actually, to enjoy that benefit. If you're not in it, I'll come back to what it means for your trade relations with those 53. But countries like South Korea, South Africa, Mexico have free trade agreements, and it would facilitate our trade with them. But WTO rules require substantially all trade to be covered, and you wouldn't be able to negotiate your own free trade agreements with the rest of the world, which is seen by the OUTAG as being one of the big arguments, our freedom to actually lead the world in free trade, etc. Well, you couldn't do it. And you'd have no preferential access for services. So customs union, not so easy. Well, the third might be a series of bilateral agreements between the United Kingdom and the European Union. Switzerland has that model. It has more than 100 agreements, and it took more than 10 years actually to negotiate, and there are lots of lovely tensions in it. People of Switzerland in a referendum in the last 12 months said, we've had enough of free movement, let's limit free movement. The community's, the EU's response immediately was to say, so you have cooperation with research programs of the EU. If you don't go back to free movement, we're stopping that cooperation. We're kicking you out of all the EU research programs. Switzerland is modifying its stance now, and I think going back to another referendum on free movement. And in practice, as well as the complexity and the time it's taken, there's no passporting of services. And in practice, Switzerland's been forced to accept EU rules on competition, state aids, on environment. We've seen it on transport and tunnels through to Italy and so on, and crucially, free movement. So, not such a good agreement. The fourth then, let's have a bespoke United Kingdom European Union agreement. Let's make it comprehensive. We'll include free trade, and if we can't do the internal market, we'll do our best to cover all the issues that we want. So we'll have justice, home affairs, university research, whatever. We'll put it all in this agreement. There's a political problem there, which is none of the other 27 want to see the United Kingdom enjoying the same privileges or better privileges outside the EU than it did within. And the answer is obvious why. Because that would be a marvelous incentive for lots of people to leave the EU. So the club is saying, no, only so much are we prepared to give you, and our chances actually of negotiating something like that, I think, are limited by the extent of what they'd be prepared to offer. So the last one is, which is often the subject raised, was raised in the referendum campaign, let's just go for WTO rules. That's very simple. You don't need lengthy negotiations, no payments into the EU budget, free movement doesn't come up, and you're free to negotiate what you like with third countries. Up to a point, Lord Copper, as they say, no preferential access to the single market, no passporting of services. 5,500 companies currently enjoy passporting, which is why we have the surplus of 20 billion. You'd have so many customs officers that you would have to recruit. It would be the only real growth area, simply to manage the controls on borders. And the exports that the UK would put in would be dependent and have to meet essentially whatever the external tariff of the EU currently is. So if you're a poultry farmer, the bad news is it would be 200% tariff. If you were just beef, it comes down to 49%. That's what British exporters would be having to export across. And the argument that, well, they would face a tariff from us doesn't work quite so well because the items that they most send us have lower tariff points. But we'd also have to reach agreement with 113 countries in the WTO on the schedule of tariffs. The schedule of tariffs is just the technical term for the duties we would apply to all the goods that we could potentially import. So there are some of the options. And my conclusion would be, or isn't one of them, or that is an easy fit for the United Kingdom. And I cannot think of another option. So we come back to now the processes that need to be put in place if Article 50 happens. I've done Article 50, I've done the future relations. The third one, we need to unscramble EU legislation in the UK. Return power to Westminster. British Parliament should be sovereign, so enough of this nonsense of EU legislation being enforced upon us. I don't know how many directives there are which cover the internal market, but it's 4,000 plus. They are currently the law of the United Kingdom. They may have been implemented in Westminster, in Cardiff, in Scotland, depending on the competence of the subject, but they're part of British law. when we leave the EU, they remain part of British law. That's easy. Because for the most part, we voted for those things because we like them. But they represent, and I'm not a lawyer, but about two-thirds of EU law affecting the United Kingdom. The other third comes from the treaties, from the jurisprudence of the European Court of Justice, and crucially, from things called regulations enacted invariably by the Commission under powers granted by the Council and the treaties, and which have, in the jargon, direct effect upon the United Kingdom. I.e., they're directly applicable without the need for national implementation. So, to be generous and say there are only 1,000 pieces of such legislation. So at a stroke, what do? Do we just say they fall away when we leave, or do we need them? And this is where another con comes in. The British government intends to enact the Great Repeal Act. Now, at first sight, if you're going to repeal, you're going to strike it off, so it no longer has an effect. Actually, what they want to do in the Great Repeal Act is to make applicable in UK law, the moment we leave, all these things which otherwise would fall off. So 1,000 or more so things. It is unimaginable, but on the timescale, that Westminster would be able to consider each and every one of those, or appropriately, the legislatures in the devolved areas. So officials are going to go through these things, and they're going to tick and say, and it's going to be in the Great Repeal Act. So the democracy that we are believing that we're creating is actually going to be officials going through and approving what should be British law. That's how it's going to work, and those who've done history will know that it's effectively Henry VIII and the powers that he exercised, which is to simply and summarily say, these are part of law. And if that were not a bit of a problem, what is a far bigger problem is that many of those things having direct effect are part of a regulatory framework for a particular area. So if we're talking about telecommunications, approval of pharmaceuticals, energy, aviation, there are European Union agencies which have a role within the legislation of these regulations. So if we're just going to repeal, i.e. make these part of British law, which agency is going to be competent? Are we creating new agencies, and is all that going to be done in the time available, or would we still leave these EU bodies to be competent for what was governing us for as long as we chose to keep those provisions part of British law? No one's answered that. And the thing about the Great Repeal Act, there's another wee problem, which is the British government intends to legislate in Westminster, but each of these areas is part of British law. But there are a lot of them which cover areas which are the competence of the devolved administrations. Now, that doesn't matter as long as they have direct effect. Because as of now, direct effect applies in England, Scotland, Wales, Northern Ireland in exactly the same way. It doesn't matter who has competence. It's overriding. When it's not overriding, has the British government yet twigged the extent to which, in drafting its repeal act, it should be saying, well, we can do it for England, but in certain areas we can only do it for Scotland, Wales, whatever. Messy. My fourth area has to do with the substitute policies that need to be in place on the 1st of April 2019. obvious one is agriculture. Common agricultural policy applies. When we're no longer in the EU, it doesn't. So what's the agricultural support system going to be in the United Kingdom on that magic day? In determining what it should be, you've got to take account of, one, you need a system of actually giving assistance to farmers, so there's got to be a series of different systems in place. You need to have worked out how much are we prepared to pay nationally to support agriculture, and thirdly, what are we allowed to do to support agriculture given what our international agreements on trade may or may not say at that time. They may permit us to do whatever we like. They may, and more likely, they will constrain severely the extent and the manner in which we can aid agriculture. But the important point is that, and just taking agriculture as a subject, there are four different administrations, each of which is going to have to work out what does it want to do on agriculture. And they're going to have to take a plain sheet of paper and start writing a new policy. And hopefully they'll cooperate a bit between each other. The Welsh First Minister has suggested very sensibly that there should be common standards on health of animals and plants. Why? Because otherwise moving cattle between the different nations would be very difficult. The immediate Scottish response was to say, that's a devolved competence, we're not prepared to give that back to London and have any external control on what we should do. Whereas the sensible attitude by the four should be to say, we have a problem, we ought to share our resources and work out what each of us could do and then choose what we're going to do, but especially work together to avoid any problems which might inhibit internal trade. That's just talking about agriculture, but there are a whole series of other policy areas where officials have been accustomed to simply applying regulations and running a system. In agriculture, well, how do we pay? Who do we pay? Can we check? We should make this payment. It's an entirely different problem to say, what do we put instead of the common agricultural policy? And do we have the capacity and the expertise, and I remind you, to do this in the space of 25 months? So my fifth thing, the challenge, is, well, we've got to negotiate our agreements with third countries. Now, if we stay in the customs union, we don't have to worry about the 53 or so countries. If we don't choose to stay in the customs union, immediately we have a problem that we have no trading relationship with 53 countries. And that includes Mexico, South Korea, South Africa. We've got to negotiate with them. We've got to negotiate our new relation with the WTO, whatever happens. And all that at a time when, if there were a handful of people expert in trade policy in Whitehall, I would be surprised. So I come to my sixth. If, and the tenor of what I'm saying is, this may not be negotiable, all of it, in 2 years, i.e. no chance, we need a transition arrangement, or we need interim, whatever you're going to call it. Transitional tends to imply a bridge to something. Interim tends to imply, well, we'll stay interim until we've worked out what it is we want to do. But if you're going to stay interim, that means you're staying in. And that, of course, is not really possible. So goodwill on both sides is going to be necessary to say, well, because we failed to conclude all these things in the manner we would have liked, what are we going to do meanwhile to make sense of the relations? All that requires a great deal of judgment, a great deal of pulling together what is necessary and try to work out a strategy. Now, the white paper may confound us all and may have a lot of that in it. But negotiations which start on the basis if they don't want to penalise us, they don't want to make it easy for us either, and we've got French, Dutch, German elections, and Lord knows what else coming up on the calendar, and for an EU which has two massive problems, the Eurozone and whether that's going to survive, and the whole problem of refugees coming in from outside, for them it's an irritation having to do all these negotiations. So is there enough goodwill, is there enough good sense? I don't know. What I'm clear about is you don't start a negotiation on the basis we're not doing X, Y, and Z, because you've got nowhere to go. What you have to say is, what we would like to achieve is the following, and then you tease out, in the end, what are we prepared to pay for what we can achieve, and are they on the other side prepared to give us that much for what they're going to get? And you have to get to that position. Whether or not you have people able to do that, prepared to do that, time will tell. I think there's a problem in Whitehall, and I'll relate it to my previous department, that the Foreign Office used to be the voice of trying to see globally what the national interest was, take some account of others' views, and then present a view. The person now sitting in my old job can't easily do that in Whitehall. Why not? Because, well, the others are hard over Brexiteers who want out, and my successor is sitting there saying, well, I think we should do X, Y, or Z, and I insist this goes to ministers. And what happens when it goes to ministers is that Boris Johnson is hardly likely to support the individual who's trying to be rational for some sort of outcome which best meets British interests, because they're all locked into those things that they said they would do without, for the most part, having any idea what the consequences were. Now, what does all this mean for UK foreign policy? It didn't figure in the referendum, yet the UK role in foreign policy over the last 40 years has probably been one of the few successes of our role within the European Union. The EU external relations are sufficiently complicated with what is community competence, what is member state, but on the whole, the British have managed to negotiate and come back with outcomes which actually furthered British foreign policy objectives. You may remember 2 years ago, the coalition government did an exercise on what they called the balance of competence, and they did it on all the subjects where the British impinged on the European Union and vice versa. And the conclusion on foreign policy and common foreign security policy was, and I quote, the majority of the evidence is generally in that it's strongly in the United Kingdom interest to work through common foreign security policy. Now, foreign policy is determined by interests, as we see in the United States at the moment, by values, by international law, respect for human rights, multilateral cooperation, and realistically, many of the challenges that we face externally involve multilateral cooperation. That's the nature of the global issues that confront us. I could tell you, and it's the truth, that we're members of G7, that we're the second largest contributor to NATO, with a permanent seat in the Security Council, we're members of the Commonwealth, we're part of G20, we share intelligence with the fifth largest economy. All those things, they're all true. But the but is, it seems to me, we live in an increasingly uncertain, dangerous world. If you think about resurgent Russia, Middle East, Syria in particular, China, its aspirations, North Korea, United States, which the EU has recently declared a threat to the European Union. It's pretty uncertain. And this is a moment when brave old Blighty has decided we are going to go sailing into mid-Atlantic to an uncertain future. Frankly, it scares the pants off me, because at a time when you're tackling those problems, need to do it with other people, we are lacking allies. The demands in NATO, yes, we'll have to do more in NATO, but that's not going to carry the water of all the other things we've got to do. And as for future cooperation with the European Union, when in the General Assembly of the United Nations, the EU representative says, now speaking on behalf of the European Union and the following 12 countries, and it probably is 12, who have associated themselves with this statement. So 39 countries are saying, very powerfully, is that what we want? Do we want to be one of the 12 who associate themselves with what the European Union has already decided? Because they will have decided, and they will not have consulted us, and we will have a choice, take it or leave it. I've done those negotiations with the 12, and it's very simple. We'd love to have you on board, but if you don't want to come, so be it. But you're coming on our terms. That's what will confront us. So, our number one ally, the special relationship, the United States. We scurry off to Washington to be the first. There's something a bit undignified about it, but okay, it produces results. But does anybody in this room really believe that there is a thing called a special relationship? I'm not sure. And the reason I'm not sure is that the United States is driven by its own interests. And for as long as the UK interest complements and reinforces the United States, that's fine. Otherwise, have we historically had the dividend from the special relationship? Well, people will write about that for a long time. But you could argue Israel, Ireland, Canada have a more special relationship with the United States. It's worth thinking about. But do not assume that because now we are out, the United States will embrace us and everything will be terrific. I don't think it'll be like that. And of course, there's always a problem about external perception. We have an irritating habit for the rest of the world in saying, we are the leaders. We are the leading member of the European Union. This is our chance to lead the world on free trade. If we sometimes removed the definite and replaced it by the indefinite article and said, we have a leadership role, others would find it more palatable. But this assumption somehow that good old Britain can do all these things, when our influence is frankly going to be diminished by not being in the European Union, I doubt it. So what are the risks? That we'll foul up our relations with the EU, that economic nationalism will grow, that we'll be isolated, estranged from the EU, from the United States. Xenophobia internally might intensify, and we've seen some of that already, and self-delusion will persist, and the rest of the world, famously as a Russian said not so long ago, when briefing unofficially, said, well, it's a small, declining, unimportant country. Well, we're not, but our chance of being more influential and of using the membership of the EU to be more influential, to do more effectively things we wanted to do, that's now something we're deprived of. But the positive, this is an opportunity, we're told, to chart a more independent course, to work with those allies out there, to demonstrate our leading role in all of these things, and to demonstrate this commitment to the free, liberal trade, which unfortunately the rest of the world seems to be a little bit going the other way. The chance to emphasize our values, yes, we were doing that. Our support for the international rules-based order, yes, we were doing that. And at the very time that President Trump is bringing that into question in all sorts of areas, that's the moment when a united EU would have been better placed, in my view, to have responded to it. We'll be able to do our bit, but I don't think it will be as effective. So my conclusion is it's all going to be pretty difficult. I was going to talk about the role of devolved administrations. You covered that earlier. I will simply point out this. The British government, in the Government of Wales Acts successively and the Government of Scotland Acts successively, has made it clear that external issues are reserved for Westminster. That was perfectly logical when we were talking about defence, foreign policy, obviously for the United Kingdom,
they're represented by Westminster. External policy today is those issues plus globalization, all the global issues, climate change, environment, trade, agriculture, and so on. And a large slug of those has been devolved. The British government has said it will consult the devolved administrations. There's a meeting in Cardiff on Monday. The extent to which that consultation is real, I'm dubious about. And what doesn't make sense is that a British government believes that it can go have all these different negotiations and then come to conclusions which will impact directly on the responsibilities and the powers of the devolved administrations. By the way, who in their founding provisions in each of these acts are required to follow and give priority to any EU legislation which affects their territory. That's the irony of it. But the British government has to do better, my view, from the beginning in getting people from Cardiff, Edinburgh, Belfast involved in things, not paying lip service to and then having a meeting of ministers where, having listened, not necessarily heard the views of the different first ministers, the Prime Minister then concludes, well, this is how it's going to be. That's how it's going to be for a lot of foreign policy, but it shouldn't be for UK policy working externally. And the implications for Britain, if it is to be done in that way, is that the unity of our kingdom is going to be very much brought into question. Let me stop there.